day. Take a blanket made for two now.
And a boy and a girl.
That's a game for me and you now.
Yeah, let's give it a whirl.
Beach blanket bingo. Beach blanket bingo. Beach blanket bingo. That's the name of the game.
Every lad and
every lassie
playing down by the shore. Looking smart
and looking classy.
Yeah, they're learning the score.
A beach blanket bingo. A beach blanket bingo. Beach blanket bingo. That's the name of the game.
The game. When a lad just meets a lassie and he asks for a kiss, then he finds a lassie sassy.
Right blanket,
wrong man.
Beach blanket bingo. Beach blanket bingo. Beach blanket bingo. That's the name of the game.
Play the game like you should do now.
That's the start of the fun.
When you find
a girl for you now,
bingo, you won!
Beach blanket bingo. Beach blanket bingo. Beach blanket bingo. That's the name of the, that's the name of the, that's the name of the game.
Let's try now. Can you hear me okay?
Yep.
All right. Very cool. Hello, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Logan Crow. I'm the executive director and founder of the Frida Cinema in downtown Santa Ana. And with me are the amazing Craig and Becca'lise of This Cinematic Life. How are you doing?
Good.
Glad to be back.
Yep.
Glad to be back too. So for those of you who maybe this is your first time watching this particular trio talk and discuss films, this is something we started doing, maybe a month and a half ago, already 2 months, pretty much right after.
Because, I mean, because we did five of them and then we've been off for about a month. So
yeah, pretty much right after COVID hit and we started to look at how do we keep our conversations going about film? How do we keep our friends in the spotlight and find opportunities to catch up? And it's been great. We've been sharing top 10 lists based on themes and ideas that we've thrown around together. And it's given us a great opportunity not only to talk film, which we love to do, but catch up with folks and see folks in the chat. I see Colin, Kami, who I believe is mom. Is that right? I always forget. I know that there's some where it's like mom's in there.
No,
our moms are not here tonight. Yeah, Colin and Rachel.
Okay. So we are, as always, what's up?
I missed her.
We are, as always, happy to hear from folks in the chat. So if you have any questions or want to throw out some love for one of the films or have a film of your own to suggest, we love it. But basically, we've done, top 10 films to give you a little bit of a travelogue while you're quarantined, top 10 films that take place in one place, top 10 moms. We didn't do top 10 dads. We missed that opportunity, but there's always the future. Go ahead.
Sci-fi guilty pleasures.
Yes. Yes, the guilty pleasures one. That was a blast. And you had recommended this one a while back, which was top 10 summer films. And I'll tell you how I approached it. So, we looked at it as, is it top 10 films about summer? Is it top 10 films set in summer? Top 10 films that make you feel summer? Or for that matter, top 10 films that, is it the best 10 or your favorite 10? So what I went with is my favorite 10 films that that involve summer or that take place in summer or that recall summer, as opposed to maybe the 10 best. And there are some couple guilty pleasures here and there. How did you go about your list?
Well, I'm very, it was hard for me because I'm very, very seasonal in my movie watching, and I watch a lot of the same movies every year on the same time of year. And so, for example, I like to watch a lot of sci-fi during the summer, but I was looking at it, I was like, okay, none of these are necessarily set in the summer, and it's just like my own personal weird preferences. So I tried to keep it to set in summer or summer, that summery vibe. But yeah, it was, this was a hard one for me.
Yeah, same summer vibe. Heat was a big thing, like films that I felt like made you feel warm, like, you know, that related heat really well. And then, you know, summer activities like beach and such.
What's that?
Just general summerness.
Yeah.
Very, very cool. So let's get started. Tell us your number 10 summer film. And by the way, folks, what we've been doing as well is, you know, we want to make sure that you have access to the film. So we will share with you the film, but as well as where you can stream it. So obviously, if ideally, it's always, you know, somewhere that we can stream it for free. But some of them are available for paid rentals. So we'll let you know where you can go to find it. But what is your number 10?
Number 10 is Richard Linklater's sophomore film. Like, I think actually it was his third, but nobody really saw the first one. But After Slacker, in 1993, his first studio film, Days Confused, set on the last day of school in a high school in Texas in 1976. So it's like, that's when I organize my part of this list, I don't necessarily have like best, you know, number 10 is the least and number one's the best, but this one I felt like starting the list with because it was a start of summer, you know, the last day of school is the start of summer. But yeah, it's one of those all in one day movies, you know, follows a huge cast, you know, similar to like American Graffiti, and also similar to American Graffiti, a big cast of people that would go on to, you know, become names in their own right. You know, you got Ben Affleck in there, and then of course Matthew McConaughey, famously, you know, that's where, you know, the all right.
Right.
But yeah, just huge cast, not really a plot. You know, you kind of got two protagonists. You got, what's his name? Which London is it? Jason, I had to, because London Brothers is Jason London. He's like the older of the two protagonists and having to decide, you know, whether or not to like sign a little pledge thing about not doing drugs to maintain his spot on the team. And then Wiley Wiggins is, I can't remember if he's like about to be, he's going to be going into freshman year, or maybe he's a freshman about to go into sophomore, but yeah. And then his fear of torment from the seniors who will paddle him with a big like wood paddle, and trying to avoid them, and, you know, meeting a girl, first love type things.
Well, actually, I got a peek at yours, and it helped me whittle mine down because there's a lot of repeats. So I was like, okay.
Logan's covering that.
I need to know that's going to be covered by somebody, I don't care who, but
thank you, Blake. I guess my audio cut out. Thank you. Is your audio okay? So yeah, no, you're good. So what we were talking about was you know, that it's a great pick, that it was a very nightmarish vision of high school if you grew up in Austin. And that when I first saw it, when it first came out, my first thought was, thank God I did not go to school in Austin because of the hazing rituals that they would do on freshmen that were entering the new school. But just a great film, great soundtrack, great vibe. So many, you know, Parker Posey,
Lauren Adams.
Young Mila Jovovich singing. I mean, it's a lot of very, very young faces that we will see later. Joy Lauren Adams, like you said. Right on, great, great pick. What I said also before my audio cut out was that, so we put both of our top 10 lists on a spreadsheet, and I like ignored Craig and Becca's as I put mine together so that I wouldn't be influenced, whatever. I guess they saw mine and removed some of theirs. So I am curious afterwards if we had any films that would have been on your list that maybe you took off so that there would be no repeat. Okay, great. So my number 10 is Ari Aster's 2019 film Midsommar. A film that's got summer right there in the title. What is remarkable about Midsommar is it is one of the rare horror films that takes place almost completely in bright, bright sunlight. And it's visually gorgeous at the same time that there is some really, really, really disturbing graphic imagery in the film. I've always, for some reason, had an appreciation for films that sort of conflate or mix up the grotesque and the beautiful. Peter Greenaway's films, mm-hmm. The Cook, the Thief, His Wife, and Her Lover, growing up, was a personal favorite. horror and grotesquery, beautiful. And Midsommar certainly does that. It's also surprisingly humorous. It's a pretty dark comedy. It's got a lot of dark comedy in it that propels the story along. Some great characters, a lot of allegory, a lot of symbolism, which I also love. But definitely the darker side of summer on that particular title. What do you got next? Oh, sorry.
I'm saying I haven't seen Midsommar. I'm scared.
Really?
Hereditary, yeah.
I haven't seen either of them. I'm scared.
So, have you seen Hereditary?
No. We're both Ari Aster virgins.
I know.
Oh, wow. I'd be interested, for those of you who are on the chat, if you've seen both, maybe throw in which one you preferred. Because I feel like you have your Hereditary camp and you have your Midsommar camp. And personally, I really do love Hereditary more. But it's interesting it's one of those things where I totally hear the argument behind Midsommar being the superior film. They're both great. I will say that there is very little comic relief in Hereditary. There is very little you can lean against to try to shake off a lot of the darkness in that film. And moreover, it's a very dark film visually as well. It's not gorgeous and beautiful. It's very beautifully made and shot, but not a visually beautiful film, whereas Midsommar allows for a lot of imagery to sort of entertain you. But both great films, both worth checking out. Colin, haven't seen either yet either. Check out these films. Hereditary especially is one of the most disturbing films I've seen.
Yeah, I kept hearing it messed me up. Like, that movie messed me up. And I'm like, I don't know if I can handle that. I'm kind of a wimp.
And it's one of those films, I saw it, loved it, got messed up by it, saw it again a couple days later in the theaters, took someone else to see it, oh my God, loved it. And then about a month and a half later, the Directors Guild of America had a screening where they had Ari Aster out. And I'm like, oh, I'll go just see it again. And it would have been a month before it since the last time I saw it. and there was something about that third screening that I was terrified the whole time. I knew everything that was going to happen, but I was so unsettled. And that's rare for me, where I'm revisiting a film for past the second time and feel the horror of it all the more, if not strangely more so than I had before. It's just really effective. Very sad. It knows, it mixes the you know, there's nothing more horrible, I guess, than intense sadness. And there's some of that in both films, really. Really pretty intense films. Blake says, I've seen both and I liked Hereditary more upon viewing, but I think about Midsommar a lot more and I think it's more rewatchable. Yeah, no, absolutely. Midsommar is a lot more rewatchable. Again, more I think visually pleasing. Your number nine, I haven't seen. So tell us about your number nine.
Oh, my number nine is 1958's Bonjour Tristesse. It's kind of hard to find, actually. The Criterion Channel has it streaming right now. It's a newish find to me. I've seen it maybe twice now. It stars Gene Seberg and David Niven. They're a father and daughter. They go vacationing in the French Riviera. And it is just the most like bougie, summery, like they're just in swimsuits in the ocean, and they have this house and a maid, and he's there with his girlfriend. I should have written down her name. I don't know who plays the girlfriend. She's hilarious. She's got this like German-ish accent. It's like really over the top, and she's just like ditzy and glamorous and funny. But so they're all vacationing together, and then his sort of ex-girlfriend, love interest person, he invites her along too, and then the drama unfolds. But just the whole vibe of the film is very like ultimate vacation mode, like suntan skin, you can smell the ocean in this movie, and they're just like living the life. And the daughter, Jean Seberg, she's very threatened when this new love interest of her father shows up, because it means the party's over, basically, because they're very close. They just travel and go to parties and live this decadent life, and so she kind of interferes, and I won't spoil it because it's really good, and they have flashbacks, and the meat of the story is in color, and then when she's reflecting on it in the present, it's all very black and white and gritty looking. So that was a nice little surprise visually for me. Yeah, the costumes, the glamour, it's just, yeah. I'm like, I just want to go to their little vacation house and just like lay out and listen to the ocean. It's just so, it's such a chilled out vibe. And the story is just really interesting too. It's funny, it's tragic. Deborah Kerr plays the love interest. And so she's great. And just, yeah, it's a good eye candy movie. And you just want to travel and look great while doing it, and yeah, I enjoy it a lot.
Great, definitely a classic I need to catch up with. Yeah. My number nine, I just recently watched. I won't say much about it, but it's just I found it really, really enjoyable. Is Adventureland from 2009, from director Greg Mottola. This is a movie that I don't know if it was because Zombieland had come out right around the same time, or something about the title and just the vibe. And there were a lot of sort of, comedies coming around that time that were kind of sophomoric. It did not appeal to me. And I remember almost immediately people were speaking about the film very positively. And, I do obviously watch a lot of, art films and genre films, but I do like popcorn cinema. I do enjoy mainstream cinema. But I didn't give this one a chance, and I recently caught up with it and was really surprised by just how much it affected me. It is a nostalgic film about, essentially at its heart, it is about, it's a nostalgic film about that first person that sort of steals your heart away, that first sort of teen love that that you sort of get beguiled by and mesmerized by and lose a little bit of yourself and your sanity too. And it was just wonderfully done. I have been a Kristen Stewart defender for a bit now, because I think that because of the Twilight films, she gets a bad rap. But this is a film where I think her, you know, what she can bring to a film really shines. You want to know this person and follow them. And it's one of those characters that is delivered so well that you can totally find yourself empathizing really with both of them as they are falling for these other characters. They're delivered so well and so real. And it's got a great nostalgic soundtrack, and it's, you know, filled with these colorful characters who work at this amusement park where Jesse Eisenberg's character does a summer job, and that's where he encounters her. Just a great film. Great film. Surprisingly great. Romantic, funny, everything you'd want. And again, very nostalgic, very... just very sweet. And very real.
Yeah, it almost made my list, but it had been a few years since I'd seen it, so I wanted to revisit it, but we threw these lists together in a matter of days. I didn't have a chance to revisit it. It very well probably would have made my list if I had had a chance to kind of refresh on it. But I own the Blu-ray, yada yada.
You're a fan?
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I was really impressed by it. Your number 8 did not make my list, but when I saw that it was on, I'm like, it's a great one. This is one of my favorites. But talk to us about number 8.
Number 8 is the Coen brothers' Palme d'Or winning from 1991, Barton Fink. I mean, it's not explicitly a summer movie. I mean, you know, there's a famous image of a woman on a beach in it, but it's one of those heat movies. It's about a playwright from New York. He's got a big hit play about, you know, the working class and labor and stuff like that. And he's lured out to Hollywood to write a scary wrestling picture. And he's staying at this hotel called the Hotel Earl. And just, it's very hot there. The wallpaper is peeling, constantly having to be stuck back up. And his... room next door to him is a kind of traveling salesman played by John Goodman. So a lot of people see it as about ignoring the creeping fascism of, you know, World War II, because there's a pointed reference to Hitler near the end of the movie that I won't spoil. But one thing that I like about it is John Turturro's character is so in his own head that I'm pretty sure Pearl Harbor happens during the movie, but we never see it. At the start, it is set in 1941, but at the start there isn't war in the air and stuff. But by the end, there's a dance scene with sailors, and one of the studio heads is wearing military regalia. So somewhere during there, Pearl Harbor got bombed, and this guy was so self-involved that he, didn't even realize it, is at least a reading that I take away from it. But just really great performances, especially by Goodman and Turturro, and the Coen brothers' first film with Roger Deakins as cinematographer, really helping sell that heat and the sweat and the peeling wallpaper that I mentioned.
Yeah, it's definitely one of those movies that had a pretty big sweat budget. and as it progresses, I mean, I think John Goodman's just drenched in sweat towards the third act all the time. His back is just soaked, and yeah, no, it's a very, very hot film, for sure. Oppressive heat. I have a note. Every time you show a clip from a new movie, it's playing the same audio. That's good to know. FYI, the video clips aren't supposed to have audio, so I'm not sure what's going on there. We're having some audio issues today. The audio gremlins are here. But let's. When we play the next clip, let me know if that's still happening, folks. And I'll see what I can do about that. But there shouldn't be audio from the clips at all. So we're learning as we go along. It's funny with Barton Fink. I don't know if you have the same dilemma as I do, but if there's one director, like I love David Lynch, I love all of David Lynch's movies. It is no secret or surprise that I love David Lynch, but I can easily tell you Blue Velvet is my favorite David Lynch movie. I love all of his films. A lot of them come close, but with the Coen brothers, however, I feel like I have a different Coen brothers movie depending on the time of day and the day of the week. And I will never be able to, or I'll say, oh, it's Barton Fink, hands down. It's the one I've seen the most, which is probably true. And then I'll remember Raising Arizona. And I'll be like, oh God, no, Raising Arizona, it's poetry. It's one of the most, it's incredibly, I was referring to the day I said that it's the most subversively poetic comedy ever made, you know? And then I'll remember Miller's Crossing, and then I'll remember, Hudsucker Proxy, which I absolutely adore and defend. So it's they're just fascinating filmmakers, but Barton Fink is if not my favorite, pretty close. So I won't say much about my number either because, I mean, if you haven't seen it, catch up, but it's Jaws. It's Jaws. What can I say? It's, summer. Jaws is obviously takes place at summer, and it is about, for those of you who don't know, a shark that is menacing a city called Amity Island, and it stars Roy Scheider as the local sheriff, I believe. I might be wrong there. With supporting turns from Richard Dreyfuss as a scientist who's there to study sharks. There's a shark that's killing people in the city. He comes in to try to solve the day, and then they take off in a boat with blanking on the name here. What's that? Quint. Yes, Quint. But I still remember the actor's name. Oh gosh, Man for All Seasons. Robert Shaw. Thank you. I've never seen The Sting. I have to admit with shame. Hold on, we're gonna go back because I want to get Becca's reaction here. Hold on. I wish I could recreate that. It was aghast. She was aghast. Her hand clutched her heart. I've never seen The Sting, but apparently I need to.
It's really good.
Is it really?
I love it. Love it. My early internet username was like not even a major character in the movie, but it was totally based on like this random character from The Sting. For years, I used it as my screen name. It's really good. Please, and Robert Shaw is amazing in it. That's so really good.
Yeah, he's great. It's funny. I have not seen many Robert Shaw films. Obviously, he's probably my favorite character in Jaws. But in A Man for All Seasons, he's in like one major big scene and steals the whole movie. I mean, I would love to see more Robert Shaw films. And so that's a vote right there, The Sting. But yeah, Jaws. Watch Jaws if you haven't. It's great. It's one of those films I think that because of the love it gets and because it's such a household name, newer generations are like, oh yeah, Jaws. It's good. It's just that good. It holds up well.
Jaws would have been my number one, but I saw it was on your list.
Got it. So, it would have been your number what now?
It would have been my number one.
Number one. Right on. It's got these amazing moments. It is at its best, I think, when it's not about literally, action sequences with the shark. Those are great too, but really it's about these three men. And it's very political as well. You'll see it in memes a lot right now in terms of the local sheriff who wants to keep business afloat despite the blood deaths that are happening in his community because of this menace, and the scientist is telling him it's killing people, but the sheriff's like, no, we gotta make money this summer. So we all made fun of that sheriff growing up, and go figure.
It's so good.
People like that don't exist. All right, we got some notes. Yes, thank you, John Carlos. The mayor is so relevant right now. That's just what we're talking about. That's what I meant, the mayor, not the sheriff. Craig, Serious Man. Yes, A Serious Man is so good. I just recently saw that for the first time, too. Jaws in 4K, that must be gorgeous. I'm skipping that one because I'm trying to stay apolitical. Then there's a sharky. Thank you, Laura. A little shark emoji. Blake is upset that I've never seen The Sting and says
it's so good.
Well, here's what's funny. So Blake says the Frida needs to play it. And then he says the Indianapolis scene is an all-timer. So so Trevor and I, Trevor's our programming director, keep talking about doing a series of where Craig, I, and Jordan and Martin, our staff of four, the I Can't Believe You Haven't Seen Blank series. So five movies Martin hasn't seen, five movies I haven't seen, Trevor and Jordan, and programming them over a series and then talking about them. So because it happens all the time. Like, I've never seen The Conversation. And people are like, oh my God! And so you got to play The Conversation. So we might do that on that fateful day when we reopen. And I'll say this very, very delicately. People keep asking us when we'll reopen. We will reopen when our local mayor in Jaws starts to take this seriously, this pandemic, and stops delaying the inevitable opening of the Frida and other places in Orange County by insisting that there's nothing to fear and that people shouldn't wear masks. So that's all. That's all I'll say about that. Tell us about your number seven.
That's me. our next pick, or my next pick, is Stand By Me from 1986. It's a classic. I feel like hopefully most people have seen it. It's the story of four boys who set off one weekend to late. They hear a story about a boy who got hit by a train and dead bodies out there. And if we go find it, we'll collect a reward money or something. It's kind of a bleak reason for a what's essentially a road trip movie, although it's a hiking trip movie, I guess. But it's just like one of those perfect coming of age type movies. And there's something so forever linked about the end of summer and growing up. Like, I feel like there's a dozen off the top of my head movies of, you know, the coming of age summer movie. There's so many of them, and it's a perfect metaphor, you know, that fun's over, you know, we're men now kind of a thing. And the performances are so good. Like, River Phoenix, come on.
Yeah.
He's so good. Will Wheaton is really good too. Corey Feldman, and I can't remember.
Jerry O'Connell.
Thank you. I was like, O'Connell? the one they all like to dump on. it's heartbreaking. It's funny. It's boys being boys, and they're silly and gross, but they get so raw with their feelings and them and nature and getting to the heart of like what has broken them already in their short lives, and that male friendships. We need boy friendship movies, you know? It's like, it's okay to get vulnerable with your feelings, and, you know, maybe if this, I think because they're alone in the wilderness, they feel the freedom to sort of be more vulnerable with each other. And not all of, I mean, there's Will Wheaton and River Phoenix are closer to each other than to the other boys, but.
Sure.
It's just that great. I think I looked it up, and it says it takes place on Labor Day weekend. So it's like really the kind of the end of summer, like the last little hurrah of their, as they're entering the adolescence. And it's just, it's really good. It's really sad, but I tried to bunch my sad movies towards the tail end of the list so we could get to the fun stuff. And I didn't want it to all be tragic, but Stand By Me is really good. It's got that sort of endless summer campfire vibes and just you and the great outdoors and good stuff.
It's a great film, and it's got that, without any spoilers, a visual motif at the very, very end that was all the more heartbreaking given something that happened in reality to one of the actors that is always so haunting for me when I rewatch that movie. So heavily influential. I will always love a lot of the structure of the film was applied in John Singleton's Boys in the Hood, down to shots of the four boys looking for a body, and then that same visual at the end of the film when talking about Doughboy. It's a great film, great soundtrack, nostalgic, very funny, and yeah, like you said, very touching. And I love the all the John Cusack scenes.
Yes.
You know, and I forget sometimes when I rewatch the movie about just how much John Cusack character, I can't remember his character's name, is in the film and sort of is all over the film. Mm-hmm. You know, great pick. I love it. I haven't seen it in a long time. It definitely one I want to revisit. Blake says these picks are on fire right now. I love Stand By Me. I set up a backyard movie theater with a 112-inch screen, and this was the first thing I watched on it this summer. Great pick.
Nice.
Speaking of putting movies on screens, we did this last week with To Kill a Mockingbird. My number 7, directed by Robert Mulligan, based on the amazing novel by Harper Lee. This is just one of my favorites. An amazing adaptation of a you know, obviously one of the most beloved books of all time. And what I love of, you know, there's so much I love about the film, there's little details that I love. And you know, one of the, you know, there are two sort of parallel stories happening at once, which is you've got the trial that Atticus Finch, the attorney, has taken on. You're also following these children as they, you know, just kind of spend their days running around their community, their city of Macomb, and you know, kind of their interactions with that trial, but also their hunt for Boo Radley and everything else. But part of the charm of the film is that they've got this little friend named Dill Harris. And Dill is actually inspired by the real-life Truman Capote, who was friends with Harper Lee when apparently he was a little boy. And he shows up every summer, and it's the big deal, and he's like part of their trio. And for the most part, as these kids are running around doing their thing, they're with Dill, and he's such a huge part of their journey here. But then he goes home at the end of the summer every year. And every time I watch it, it just recalls, you know, those friends that you had that were just such a huge seminal part of your life, but who for whatever reason, were seasonal. They would go away, you know, for whatever reason, either you were seasonal or they were seasonal. I went to a summer camp for, I think, 6 years straight with a local school when I was in elementary school. And I remember I had very specific friends that that I would see. Similarly, today, to this day, I go to the Art House Convergence once a year in Utah, and it's my one opportunity to see a lot of people who I consider to be friends, but we see each other once a year. So I always love that element of To Kill a Mockingbird, that you know, recalling those friends that we spend our life, you know, so much of our important moments of our life with, but that we only see every summer or every once in a while. So that was why that film came to mind. Great film. For those of you who don't know, we have been doing a roaming pop-up drive-in, little plug. We've done The Princess Bride. This weekend we've got two sold out ones, La La Land and Goonies. We'll be coming back 4th of July weekend, hopefully, with a couple films. But we did To Kill a Mockingbird. It was our first one that we did in Santa Ana, and it was wonderful to see that sell out and to see a lot of folks who'd never seen it. So that was exciting to share that film. Talk to us about your number 6.
Number 6, well, we, in all of these, you know, you've done ties and Becca's done, like, she did all the Harry Potters in one as a group tie. So I was stuck between these two movies. I'm like, dang it, it's my time to do a tie. So I picked two Spike Lee joints released 10 years apart exactly. 1989's Do the Right Thing and 1999's Summer of Sam. Obviously, Do the Right Thing, very relevant right now in this you know, world post the murder of George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, and numerous other Black people killed by cops, defund the police. So obviously very relevant movie set on one block in Brooklyn on one day, the hottest day of the year. You know, I have Spike's book about the making of it, where it was his journal that he kept as he was writing and while he was making the film. And, you know, the heat was very important to him because he had, you know, heard that, like, oh, when the temperature goes up, you know, like, you know, people speak their mind more, you know, their tempers are shorter, and they're more likely, you know, tensions are more likely to come to a head. And, you know, there had been several incidents, you know, involving police. You know, the Howard Beach situation is one in that era. And so stuff like that was on his mind. And so he made that film. And then 10 years later, he kind of widened the scope from a single block to the entire city of New York. And instead of a single day, to a summer. And it was the summer when the Son of Sam serial killer was shooting couples in New York. David Berkowitz was the serial killer, but it was also a hot summer. There was even a power outage partway through due to the heat. And so, you know, just on a whole citywide scale of, you know, this paranoia about this serial killer, and you got Adrian Brody as this, you know, member of this Italian American community who all of a sudden has gotten into punk and, you know, is, you know, now bisexual. And, you know, so like, oh, is he the serial killer? You know, his own, you know, the people he grew up with are kind of looking a little askance at him, like he's different. So maybe he's, you know, a killer now. It's, but yeah, just very much the same idea of heat and short tempers and stuff like that. So yeah, two great Spike Lee movies, both two of my, Spike's worked with a lot of cinematographers, but Ernest Dickerson, who did Do the Right Thing, and Ellen Curris, who did Summer of Sam, are my two favorites that he ever worked with.
Great picks, great picks. I have to see Summer of Sam again. It's been a while. I just remember the dog. that was creepy. No, yeah. great films. You might hear about one of them again in a bit. My number six is probably my most guilty pleasure on the list, and that is The Amazing Summer School from 1987 by Carl Reiner with Mark Harmon. I haven't revisited this film in a long time, so it is perfectly conceivable that it does not hold up. And for the record, when I loved this film and watched it many, many times, it was never with the idea that it was a, quote, great film. But it is just, it is so fun. And it was, you know, my sister and I are really tight, and we have our, like, list of films that we, like, for whatever reason, just love to watch together. They're part of our childhood, maybe, or we just respond to them in the same way. Kindergarten Cop comes to mind. We're just massive Kindergarten Cop fans. You know, it's one of those things where I'll never know quite why. It's not that important. She's probably watching or thinking like, well, duh, it's Kindergarten Cop. Why do you need a reason? But, you know, Summer School is one of those films. It is, you know, Mark Harmon is a sort of like stoner, cool, younger teacher who's up for tenure. That was my introduction to the word tenure. I thought it was 10 year when I was little. He's up for 10 year. He's been teaching for 10 years. And I think the part of the reason I love it was that there is a character in the film nicknamed Chainsaw who is obsessed with horror films. And all he talks about is horror films. And there's even this scene where he stages this grisly murder scene in the classroom to scare somebody. And I responded to that as a young kid, because what am I, 11 at the time? So I loved Chainsaw. It's got all these really sort of fun high school characters. It's got these great moments. You know, first, you know, driving test, he's helping someone with a driving test. And it's just a cute story. Kirstie Alley is the love interest, and she's great. It's a fun, breezy film from Carl Reiner. Harmless, fun, bright, breezy comedy that just, you know, was one of the first films to pop into my mind when I was putting this list together. So, Summer School. Have you guys seen it?
No.
Yeah, it's not one that comes up a lot, you know, in terms of the classics that people talk about, but a fun film. What is your number five?
My number five is also a guilty pleasure that I also like to watch with my sister.
Yeah.
It is Beach Blanket Bingo. It is one of those Frankie Avalon, Annette Funicello beach movies. They made a bunch of them.
Yep.
a whole genre back in the 60s. It was like, now you will have a party on the beach 10 times. It is goofy. It is a musical. It has a mermaid. It has skydiving. It has a biker gang and a kidnapped singer and Paul Lynde and Buster Keaton shows up running around. And
oh my God.
And it is goofy. It is so silly, but they're just on the beach all the time. I don't know where their families are. Do they live there? I don't know. They're always there. And just doing the most like white dancing you've ever seen. Just getting their groove on. And yeah, I mean, there's kind of a plot, I guess. But it's just how much bananas stuff can we just throw into this movie? And yeah, it works. It's fun. It's silly. It's like all the beachwear. I just love I love 60s hair and beachwear, and it's eye candy. It's colorful. It's Frankie and Annette. Like how can you not like it? You kind of love it a little bit.
It's funny because you know how every once in a while, if you're being asked to talk about a certain type of film, whatever, you think about those films that you haven't caught up with that probably would have made your list. And as I was putting this together, I didn't think of Beach Blanket Bingo, but I thought about Back to the Beach, which I have not seen. Have you seen that?
I don't think I saw it. Did I see it?
I think we did.
I may have fallen asleep.
So I've been told that movie is a blast. And sort of recalls Beach Blanket Bingo, but with some sort of 80s cheese characters thrown in and people like Pee Wee Herman who shows up and sings Surfing Bird and stuff like that. So I was wondering if I would see that on your list and then saw Beach Blanket Bingo, which I have also not seen. My only reference to Beach Blanket Bingo, and I had to play the song to start this off, is a scene in Good Morning Vietnam where characters go see Beach Blanket Bingo at a theater in Vietnam. And that's the only reason I know that song. So another one I have to keep catch up with, admittedly, but I'm sure a great pick.
It's goofy.
One of the great Tim Carey performances.
God, he's, I forget.
On a whole, he's in a different
he's
movie.
He's completely in a different movie. He's like there's a murderous psychopath.
Who?
Tim Carey. Did you ever? He's in Paths of Glory and the Killing. Those were the Kubrick.
Yeah.
I've not seen him in a lot of other stuff, but he's a famous, like, eccentric of Hollywood. Like, oh, Tim Carey, he was legit, like, insane.
Okay.
But let's put him in this movie. Yeah. Like, why not? And, yeah, it gets, like, so bananas by the final act. You're like...
Well, it turns into, like, a 20s, like, a...
A silly, like...
Harold's of Pauline.
Yeah, it is so...
sounds like I gotta check it out. Definitely when I walk. I swear.
Seriously, like I don't know who wrote this movie. Some crazy person, but it's just fun. It's so silly, and the songs are so like they're all stuck in my head forever. I watch it mostly every year. It's just one. It's like it's summer. It's warming up. It's time for Beach Blanket Bingo. Yeah.
Definitely one I got to check out. Let me see. We have Call in To Kill a Mockingbird, one of my all-time favorite films and books, a true masterpiece. Blake, Do the Right Thing was one they had us watch in school decades ago, and to this day I watch it once a year. Heartbreaking and incredible art. Blake, I think it is awesome that your school had you watch Do the Right Thing. I used to watch Summer School on Comedy Central all the time, yes. And Yay Bleach Blanket Bingo from Adrian. So, right. Yay! my number five you heard about recently, it is Dazed and Confused by Richard Linklater. You summed it up well. Great film, great characters, a lot of young faces that ended up having careers later, and quotable, very, very quotable. And just one of those films that, you know, I was two when this movie was set. And so... It is one of those movies that manages to somehow feel personally nostalgic, even though there's no reason why it would feel personally nostalgic because I don't remember that time. But I think that Linklater really captures, these characters are so palpable and they feel real, and their concerns and even some of their like BS just rings so true. It's just a fun movie. So I'm right there with you on that one. You're number four.
Me. I went with Wes Anderson's 2012 film Moonrise Kingdom, set on the fictional New England island of, New Penzance in the summer of 1965. You got a young orphaned boy in and out of social services who's in the Boy Scouts, falls in love with a young girl who he encounters. What kind of bird are you?
yes.
And, just they, both run away together and find this little cove on the island where they kind of do their own little mini Badlands. I love Wes Anderson films, but this might be my favorite. I don't know, just something about the color blue in it even. But also I'm convinced that, a lot of the music in it is this Benjamin Britten piece called, The Young Person's Guide to the Orchestra. So it's, like teaching young kids about this is what the different instruments sound like and how, a big orchestral piece works. And, on a level, I feel like this is kind of Wes Anderson's like art film for kids. You're getting older now, this is Super 16 photography, and he throws a tiny bits of animation in there, and I don't know, it just feels like an art film for tweens, and I like that.
it's gorgeous, and it's funny when you mentioned one of my favorite gags in that film you actually kind of referenced, which is that the person who plays the social services individual, Tilda Swinton, her character's name is Social Services, which is just hilarious. Moonrise Kingdom had a really interesting effect on me, which is this. I was not a Wes Anderson fan. It was kind of difficult too, because as a film geek, people loved Wes Anderson, and I just couldn't feel like I could be part of those conversations, because I liked some of what he was doing. Like, I appreciated some things here and there about Rushmore and Road to Tenenbaums, but I wasn't in. I liked Fantastic Mr. Fox, but it's, very much sort of a different thing. Same with Isle of Dogs. But I really loved Moonrise Kingdom. I really fell in love with Moonrise Kingdom. And after watching it and really appreciating it, I thought, I kind of want to go back and rewatch those movies, because I feel like I connected to something this time that maybe I wasn't connecting to before. And I'm curious if it's in there. And it was. And now I adore some of them. I adore The Royal Tenenbaums. I just love that movie. I could watch it over and over again. I appreciate Rushmore a lot more. I actually really like Darjeeling Limited quite a bit. There's something about the one that, the big one, the hotel.
Budapest.
That I just can't figure out where my disconnect is, but I know that people love it. What's that?
Bottle Rocket.
I haven't seen Bottle Rocket. I've never seen Bottle Rocket. Maybe that's my mistake. Maybe I got to watch the first one and then everything will make sense. But I don't know. I found Grand Budapest Hotel. I don't know if I was just so sad by it. I was so sad. It made me so sad. And I don't know. I have to rewatch it. Some movies have a weird effect on me where they bum me out and I can't connect to the whimsy of it. But I walk away going, wow, I never want to see that again. But I'd have to rewatch it.
Double feature it with Barton Fink for Creeping Fascism set in a hotel.
That's not a bad idea. It's a satire. Yeah, the Hotel in New Hampshire. What was I going to say? No, Moonrise Kingdom is fantastic. And the kids are amazing. Like, he just found two great kids that sort of fit the world that he always does so well. My number four is a 12-way tie. My number four is the entire Friday the 13th series. I, again, I don't believe these movies are great. This is not my Amadeus pick. But they say summer to me. Growing up, again, I was a big film geek. I still am very much into film. Horror. A big horror geek, and I'm still very much into horror and film in general, obviously. But I do love my horror films. And growing up, the Friday the 13th movies would generally come out in summer, and for the most part, on a Friday the 13th. So May, April, August of 82, April of 84, March of 85, August of 86, May of 88, July of 89, August of 93, April of 2002, August of 2003, and then the remake February of 2009. So maybe that one doesn't fit in, but they were all summer releases, and I would get so excited. It was like, summer has arrived, Jason's back. He's got new people to hunt down and kill. The movies are a lot of fun. They are, they're not smart by any means. I mean, the plot is the same pretty much every time until we, you know, get to the point where we're like, okay, well, let's throw in someone who has telekinesis, or let's send Jason to Manhattan or space because we need to do something new, or part six that gets, throws in some comedy, but. They speak summer to me. I love them, and they also recall a time where horror and slasher cinema was a lot simpler long before the days of Hereditary and The Witch, and really putting although to be fair, Rosemary's Baby, we've had films in the past, Eraserhead, that were heady, but Friday the 13th never tried, I think, to be anything more than it was, and for that I appreciate it. Yes. Oh, that was the audio clip with the scream? Oh, that's funny. Okay, that's hilarious. Well, you've been hearing the heroine of part one / first victim of part two scream all night. Now you know what that is. Moonrise Kingdom. Elias says Moonrise Kingdom. He loves it. Blake, I got depressed realizing Moonrise Kingdom came out 8 years ago. I know, right? It's crazy. The Shining turned 40 this year. I still can't wrap my head around that. Yes to Moonrise Kingdom. It makes you feel like you live in the dreamiest summer. Absolutely. And then Blake has a question, which actually takes us right into our number three. So tell us about your number three, and then I'll get to Blake's question.
If we're not tired of talking about Richard Linklater movies, I went with 2016's Everybody Wants Some. On paper, I should not like this movie as much as I do. It is a bunch of dudes hanging out. That's it. Like it's 1980, is that? It's a college baseball team, and they're sort of the house that they live in, just outside the campus. And yeah, it's the last weekend before school starts, and they're just getting to know each other and being dudes. And I love this movie so much. I've seen it so many times. I love a great ensemble of no names. Like, before this movie, I mean, I've seen a couple of them and other things since, but at the time I didn't know any of their faces. And it's one of those movies where by the end, you know their faces so well, you know their personality so well, you feel like, because you've been hanging out with them for so long. Zoe Deutsch plays the love interest, pretty much the only female presence that has lines that isn't like, hey, I'm girl for you to try to hook up with in the background, you know? One female character that has, a brain in her head, and a bunch of guys, like, I don't know what about this movie I enjoy so much. They have such great chemistry together. It's so great seeing a group of young people hanging out with not a phone in sight. I remember when I saw it in theaters, I was like, look, they're bored. They're just like making up stuff to do. And it looks so much fun. I just want to go watch them like play ping pong or whatever. The movie has great energy. Just they're going to bars. They're daring each other to do dumb stuff. They're just kicking back. And, it's one of those fun guy friendship movies. I mean, it doesn't get like vulnerable. No one talks about their feelings, but it's just fun to see them all hanging out. The main guy, what is the actor's name?
Jenner.
Blake Jenner?
Blake Jenner, yeah.
Is the Jenner who's not a Jenner? he, you know, he kind of, you see him, he's the new guy that we're sort of following, and how he kind of like hangs out with this crowd and gets to hang out with that crowd and sort of like just floats from group to group and just is hanging. It's it's just a really fun hangout movie that I watch a lot. I watch, well, it's not a spoiler. The cast does a rap over the end credits that I've watched so many times, just that scene on YouTube, because it's so funny. And it's just like a little quick revisit of all these characters that you've come to know and love. Even the real douchey ones, you're just like, I love this guy, you know?
Raw dog.
Yeah, it's so, it's so funny and fun. And yeah, I love this movie. I've made all my friends watch it. It's great. Great fun.
Well,
yeah.
I have yet to see it. So Blake asked earlier, what do you think of Everybody Wants Some? And Blake, I have not seen it. And Craig, as you know, and sort of hate me for, I haven't seen the Before trilogy either. So I have some link ladder to catch up on. But what's interesting is that I love him. I love his films, and having not seen this film yet, I totally believe you in that these characters by the end of this film are familiar and well drawn out, because he can write dialogue so well. His first film, Slacker, which is one of my favorites and that I could probably quote. And what's funny is, why? Because it's just, it's one vignette after another, but I have just seen it so many times that I just break into it every once in a while. You know, you should quit. It's like all these little scenes that come up that just kill me. And it's a Madonna pap scene. It's all these little moments, you know, that then with Dazed and Confused, same deal. You know, you've got this amazing cast of characters that by the end, you just want to take them all home, hang out with them. And you know, or I want to know what happened to these characters. What happened to Wiley Wiggins? You know, what happened to Darla? Is she, you know, all of it, you know what I mean? Like, you know, a film of his that I really like is Bernie, which, you know, is, you know, you can tell that story in 3 minutes, but he's able to draw it out and create a world around it and do it in a really cleverly filmic way with fake interview sequences. And he's just good with characters. And so I'm excited to see Everybody Wants Some. I remember when it came out, I remember wanting to see it, didn't get around to it. Clearly it's one that I need to catch up on. Nyabula says, I'm glad to be reminded that this movie exists. It's one of Linklater's best. School of Rock is another one. I just realized the only Linklater I've ever seen is School of Rock. Go figure. And again, School of Rock's another example. It's like School of Rock is Jack Black teaching kids to play music. Slacker is a bunch of disconnected Austinites just talking. Bernie is about a true story of a mortician who killed an elderly woman. On paper, these shouldn't be as engaging as they are. And I think that that's a credit to Richard Linklater. So I'm excited to watch the movie. I have not seen it, and I promise I will watch the Before trilogy at some point. I haven't watched it. What's up?
You need a list going for you. The Sting, Before trilogy, Everybody Wants Some. There's so much conversation, I guess.
Yeah, no, and a good dialogue is hard to find, and you know, to that level. So I'm excited about it. All right, my number three, talking about films that my sister and I have watched until we can quote them backwards, is Ivan Reitman's 1979 Meatballs. I love
summer.
Are you ready for the summer? I mean, how could it not be on the list? It's got the best summer song ever. Are you ready for the good times? Good times. Meatballs is fantastic. I do not know. I will never, to my dying day, know why Meatballs finds itself in the pantheon, in the list of early 80s sex comedies. You see it brought up alongside Porky's. You see it in lists with films like this. And it's so not that film. I do not believe there's one moment of nudity in this film. I do not believe that there is a sex scene in this film. The kids certainly talk about, you know, sex and horniness, and And, you know, the language is a little blue here and there, but at its heart, it's the story of the summer camp, and Bill Murray plays this camp counselor who strikes up this really incredible friendship, mentor friendship, with a young, shy camp counselor who is, you know, shy and intimidated. And for whatever reason, Bill Murray just, you know, gloms onto him. And in the coolest sort of way, builds up his self-esteem, gets him to connect with the other counselors by just allowing his own internal youthful side to just come out and meet the kid at sort of a younger level. Meanwhile, you've got all the camp counselors and all their hijinks, and they're making fun of poor Morty and all everything else that they do. But, you know, I was excited, for example, watching Family Guy when Family Guy spoofed Meatballs, I think maybe twice, to an extent. And I'm thinking, okay, maybe it's not as, like, are Dizal and I the only people who really love this movie? You know what I mean? Because I do. I'll bring it up sometimes that people will be like, Meatballs. And they'll, if they haven't seen it, be like, it's not like a sex comedy. It's like, no, it's so good. But I just love Meatballs. I think it's very hilarious. It's very touching. It's very 70s. It is so 70s. The soundtrack is 70s. The style is 70s. It does not try to be timeless in any way, shape, or form with its aesthetic. What's that?
Bruce Lee, patron saint of self-defense. Pray for us.
It just doesn't matter. No, it's just, this is one... I love it. I love Meatballs. Rick Dees saying Meatballs for those little trivia. Meatballs, the theme song of the movie.
Lisa Loeb did a cover of Are You Ready for the Summer? And I got Lola hooked on that.
Oh, no way. Oh, that's awesome. Yeah, I mean, and it's funny. So it's got this 70s soundtrack. And true story, there's a song that plays at the end when they are all getting back on the bus and going home. And all the kids are hugging, going back to, you know, kids you only see, people you only see once a year. And there's this very melancholy, sort of Melissa Manchurist-ish song playing that I swear every year at the Art House Convergence, when we're all getting on the shuttles to go from Midway to Salt Lake City, that song starts playing in my head as I'm like hugging Magnolia and IFC goodbye. It's just ridiculous. because it's like our winter camp. But Meatballs, classic film. Check it out. It's shockingly charming, I really think. And an early sort of testament to how Bill Murray could manage to be Bill Murray turned to 11 and human at the very same time. Which is something that he's able to do, and certain actors do so well, is be the caricature that they are, but be palpable and believable at the same time. I think just an unsung 80s film. What's next for you?
So this is our number two, but my number one. Becca'lise, 1991, not the remake.
No.
Point Break. The ultimate, you know, bank robbing surfers movie.
Yes.
And, you know, that deep genre. Keanu Reeves, Patrick Swayze, Lori Petty, Gary Busey.
Anthony Kiedis
in that great, one of the great foot chase, like, scenes. You know, men shooting guns into the air while screaming, you know, because they love each other so much. just like, yeah, masculinity from a female perspective. So it's got a little bit of a distance there, you know, but just fun and just great. Johnny Utah, the ultimate name for a... FBI agent. I mean, an FBI agent.
Yes.
I can't even put it into words. I just love it so much. And maybe it's not the last Lori Petty female directed movie on the earth. Lori Petty.
Spoilers.
He hinted at other things together.
What happened now? Did you spoil something now?
To
spoil. Oh, right. Oh my God, that was Lori Petty. That's right. Yeah, no.
Tank Girls number one.
I was gonna say Tank Girls number one. No, it is. That's funny. Lori Petty, talk to you. Point Break. Yeah, no, it's just fantastic. What was I gonna say? Have you heard of the Point Break live events that they do?
I have not had the ability yet, but I've heard of. Yes.
It's just so great. Yeah, it's they go to bars, I guess, for those of you who don't know, and it's a troupe, and they put on a play version of Point Break. But to further sort of illustrate how wooden Keanu Reeves's performance was, at least to the organizer of this thing, the person who plays Johnny Utah is someone at the bar who is randomly picked to literally be the star of this entire production. So, which I think is so inspired, but now that's a great one. It's a thrill. It's a rush, and yeah, Catherine Bigelow, she's great. What's that?
Oscar winner Catherine Bigelow.
Oscar winner Catherine Bigelow.
This movie.
All right, so my number two is strangely one of my favorite films. I can say that safely. And it is the movie that I probably watched the most as a very young child. And to this day, it just hit Amazon Prime and Hulu. It has been impossible to find beyond that outside of YouTube, like a really poor quality YouTube video. Amazon and Hulu, I don't know who did it, but they've cleaned it up gorgeously. And I just rewatched it last week. First time in a while, and just I was so once again into it. You're all gonna laugh, but it's Race for Your Life, Charlie Brown, from 1977, directed by Bill Melendez. I absolutely adore this film. It is just simple. It is, it's a Peanuts cartoon. You know, I mean, what else? What can I say? You know, there's not much to say beyond that. But it's, you know, the Peanuts go, and I've got a clip, but this clip is, you know, doesn't even, you got to see this if you haven't. It's free on Amazon and Hulu. What they've done with it, I've never seen it look this good. It's gorgeous. It does not look like this clip. Don't let this clip represent this film. But it's funny. So, when I went to college, when I went to film school, I met my best friend Andy. We're best friends to this day. And we found out, you know, at some point in our friendship that we were both huge Race for Your Life Charlie Brown fans. And at some point, maybe 15 years ago, like 10 years ago, the Egyptian Theater in Los Angeles screened a 35mm print of it. And we were so stoked to go. We went, and it was packed with fans. And, you know, it was such a treat to see it on the big screen because we'd never seen it on the big screen. It's just a fun little adventure. It's the Peanuts are at summer camp, there's all these cute little references to things. They're really high on democracy, and this would have been the year after the bicentennial, so I'm sure that had something to do with it. I don't know what the zeitgeist was or what people were talking about in 1976, but every time the kids have to make a decision, Peppermint Patty has Marcy pull out the secret ballots and hands them out, and they all have to vote and fold their ballots, and it's this ongoing gag throughout the film. There's tons of stoner imagery in the film. There's a lot of like weird psychedelic sort of Easy Rider stuff happening. Like Snoopy drives a motorcycle and has like a Captain America helmet on, and the soundtrack is amazing. It doesn't exist. I have tried. I've tried looking at the soundtrack. It's got this really funky 70s guitar harmonica soundtrack going, and you know, all the different characters have their moment. It's very funny. It's got a lot of sort of subversive jokes and language in it, and then it all leads up to the big river raft race, where, you know, they're basically a race to get through this river. That's what a river raft race is. But there's these bullies, and they keep threatening to attack the Peanuts' boats, and so they're warring and everything. you know, and obviously there's so many characters, you don't know who's going to win, but then the winner wins, and it's this really great visual of the winner. I'm not going to spoil it, sailing past the finish line, but I get chills every time, the way it's shot from really high. Anyway, Race for Your Life, Charlie Brown. I've probably said way more than needs to be said about this particular piece of motion picture, piece of film, but I'm a huge fan. Have you seen it?
No.
Maybe a long time ago, but like it's been a very, very, very long time. If it's the one I'm thinking of, it's been a really long time.
Yeah, there was, because they would show Bon Voyage Charlie Brown quite a bit on TV, and then obviously the Halloween one and the Christmas one. But Race for Your Life wasn't really tied to a holiday, so they would just kind of play it in summer. And it was such a big deal for me. It was like, you know, everyone's like gathered around the TV to watch The Wizard of Oz in November. I would watch Race for Your Life, Charlie Brown. And then when VHS hit and I finally got my tape of it, I wore that thing out. But anyway, fun film, definitely worth checking out, especially who knows how long it's going to be on these streaming services, because again, it's been impossible to get a good quality of it. But just charming. Everyone may end up watching it and be like, what the hell is Logan on? But I love it. Let me go back really quickly, just read some comments. Adriana says, oh, cute. Thank you, Adriana. I appreciate it. I just kind of cleaned up a little bit. I hope The Burbs is on someone's list. It's not, but that's a good pick. Colin, no one picked the obvious choice for this list, Wet Hot American Summer. No. What's that?
It was a contender for me.
We had our runners up.
Same. It was close, but you know, I just got edged out. I was torn between that and Summer School, and then it was like, okay, come on, Logan, it's Summer School. I just like I've just seen that movie so many times. Honorable mentions: I Know What You Did Last Summer and Dirty Dancing. I didn't even think about Dirty Dancing. Laura, that's a guilty favorite, absolutely. Maybe not guilty, but sure. But yeah, Dirty Dancing would have been a good one. I Know What You Did Last Summer. It's been a while since I saw that, but I do remember that being a lot of fun. Yeah, folks, if any of you have picks of your own, jump on in. Also, as we get towards the end, if there is a list you would like to see me and Craig and Becca tackle on one of these shows, let us know, because we definitely want to start doing this again.
Yay.
So talk to us about your number one.
It's not Jaws, because I wanted to spread the love. After my dude baseball movie, I picked a girl baseball movie, and I went with A League of Their Own, directed by Penny Marshall. It's a classic. I hope you've all seen it. It is about the formation of the Women's Baseball League during the war. They were like, we need baseball still. Let's pick you two girls milking a cow and a bunch of other ball-playing ladies. And yeah, they make a team, lots of teams, and just something so like all-American and wholesome about it, just like baseball and being outside and hot dogs, and I don't know, maybe I just miss crowds.
Don't we all?
Just like, I don't even like sports, like at all. Like, I don't watch baseball, but I like a good baseball movie. And yeah, Gina Davis, Lori Petty, Tom Hanks, they're all just really good, and it's, yeah, there's just something so, yeah, it's just the summer vibes. Yeah, just being outside, playing ball, and there's a bug on the wall. Get it! Sorry. I just saw a little something. Yeah, I really like this movie, and I like the girl powerness of it all. And there's a scene that I really, 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 really like in this movie where it sort of acknowledges the time and place and the period that we're in. Because, yeah, while you're saying, you know, oh, the women only get to play baseball when the boys are gone and they don't want them anymore when the boys come back, there's another layer where the ball rolls towards this black woman, and they're like, throw it back, and she throws it far. And, you know, they catch and they kind of look, does this nod, like acknowledging them. And then they're kind of acknowledging her, like, you don't have, you know, we think we don't have this opportunity. You don't really have this opportunity. It's kind of that extra layer of like, what's the whole story here, you know? And I love that they included that just the little nod. But yeah, It's such a feel-good movie. I feel like a lot of these movies are period pieces or sort of throwbacks. Something about, I don't know what it is about the summer movie and like that nostalgia factor, but yeah, that those 40 hairdos and the baseball dresses and the swing music and, you know, Madonna swing dancing.
Yep.
And Marla Hooch, it had to be you. Yeah, it's just fun. It's a fun movie. It's very quotable. It's very, we've all seen it. I hope we've all seen it. It's great.
Yeah, definitely one if you haven't, folks, check it out. And it is, it's a, you know, it's a period piece, so it holds up very well. And another one that just feels nostalgic for a time that we just weren't there, but, you know, we feel that level of looking back, you know, and very detailed. Penny Marshall was just, I think, a very incredible talent. You know, just movies that really sort of like just tugged at your heart and were so charming, but it's a great film. Love for The Sandlot on the chat from Blake, and I can never say this, Kielman Zuspat 9. Who is that? We decided last week we knew who that was. Who was it?
It's Rachel.
Hey, Rachel. Oh, Rachel. Hey, Rachel. Okay, well, yeah. The Sandlot, yes. Sign of the Times. Laura, I don't know if that's a reference to the Prince movie or you're saying that the League of Their Own is a sign of the times. Field of Dreams. Ah, that would have totally been on my list if I thought of it. Yeah, Field of Dreams is a personal favorite. Gets me every time. Every time. It gets me when that baseball player / doctor has to make a choice. Ah! What's up?
Hate me? I hated Field of Dreams.
Really? Okay, here's what's... Yeah.
Same.
Well, I hadn't seen it until recently. Yeah. It's one of those... I've seen Field of Dreams and I watched it and I was like... But yeah, I mean, it's beloved. It's just one of those...
You're not alone. My sister and I, what's funny is, I remember Giselle and I... We always talk movies, right? And a lot of, I have this most random memories about movie going in general, because like that's where my head focus goes, whatever. And I remember when Field of Dreams came out, and she said she went to see it with a bunch of friends, and she said all the guys loved it and were crying, and all the girls hated it. That was her experience, mind you, because I know a lot of guys who hate it too, you know, and some girls who love it. But I remember her saying that. I don't remember a time where I could say that, where not only did the guys love it, but two of them were a little teary-eyed, and all the girls were like, that was stupid. Now, since then, I think she's grown to reappreciate it. I just love it. I for one thing, I'm a huge J.D. Salinger nut, and I responded to the idea of James Earl Jones's character sort of being based on J.D. Salinger and a couple of other authors, and sort of the sort of whimsy, magical realism, Americana of it all. I'm not a huge baseball guy, but I felt the love and sort of the place for baseball in that sort of conversation about America's magical past, culture, whatever you want to call it. I can appreciate it when I watch this movie. And, you know, I'm a sucker for a lot of the things that happen in that movie. Like I said, there's one moment in the film that is one of my... I get choked up every single time, where if Blake says hating Field of Dreams is something I've never heard of. What a bummer. It happens.
The devil. there's a lot that didn't make our list. That was, it was hard leaving them off. Not Field of Dreams, but Sandlot for sure.
Yeah.
Heavyweights. I really wanted to include Heavyweights because it's just like this dumb summer camp movie.
Ladybugs? Did you have Ladybugs on your short list?
I did not.
Rodney Dangerfield.
No, I didn't. I haven't seen it.
Yeah.
Also, Rear Window. Also,
oh, that's a good one.
Roman Holiday. One that I was like totally made my list and then I realized I couldn't find it anywhere was Gidget Goes Hawaiian, the second. Mm. Sure. Yeah, this was hard. This is a hard list to narrow down. That's why I peeked at yours. So I was like, oh, didn't do the right thing, and so is Craig.
Oh, you just spoiled his number one.
No, that's okay. That's all right. Yeah, no, I had in the heat of the night, but I wasn't sure if that's specifically set in summer, so I was like, I don't know, but it's definitely a warm film. There's a lot of sweat, you know, but then again, I guess from what I understand, that's the South in general, muggy and hot. But but I had that sleepaway camp. I decided I was either going to go with Sleepaway Camp or the Friday the 13th series, but Sleepaway Camp almost made it on my list. There were a couple others that'll come to me, but another admission, and again, it's interesting, I've never seen The Sandlot. You know, we've played it a few times. It's just one of those ones that I have not caught up with.
I'm worried that it's one of those ones that if you didn't grow up with it and you try to watch it as an adult, right. It's just yelling children and they're just annoying. But yeah, The Sandlot, Sandlot was my first movie review. I have a diary from when it came out. I would have been 6 or 7. And yeah, just saw The Sandlot today. It was really good. I like the dog. I'm like, look, I wrote it down.
Yay!
Like, film review, but yeah, I was raised on that movie, so even though now you watch it and you're like, oh, it's very problematic when you watch it in 2020, this here and there.
Yeah,
I mean, that's so many movies now.
That would be a great list too, movies that we loved as kids that we've rewatched recently and our jaws have hit the floor, like oh my god, Revenge of the Nerds, 16 Candles, oh my god, where I'm just like, what? Teen Wolf, there's a bunch of them where I, yeah, that's all I'll say. But that'd be a fun list, movies that, or scenes that wouldn't work today, although why put a spotlight on them? Adriana, what's that?
All of Breakfast at Tiffany's, all of the... That one's frustrating because you could just easily edit him out of that. He really doesn't do anything to the plot of the movie. There might be a couple clunky transitions, but like, he does not need to be in there. Like, how are we not just like, I don't know.
That's one of the reasons we've not played that Breakfast at Tiffany's at the theater. That character is just so terrible. There's just nothing. You can't point to anything redeemable there, but no, I'm with you on that. Adriana says, yes, Ladybugs. Colin says, Camp Nowhere.
Christopher.
Blake means, Ben Stiller's villain in Heavyweights is so underrated. Hilarious.
Have you seen Heavyweights?
I have not seen Heavyweights.
I'm just going to spoil it. Can I spoil it?
Please do. Yeah, absolutely.
I'm like full raging psychotic by the end. So he's like this fitness guru who buys the camp, like, I'm going to make any winners. And he's just crazy, and by the end he's like nutso and he's like smashing glasses on the floor and like, I'm too strong, and he's walking on the glass, and then he does this insane backflip but doesn't land it at all. He just like eats it. It's so funny. It's just,
I have to check it out. I've been
it's definitely one of those like kind of dumb kids movies.
It's a kids movie, right? Though it's like not an R-rated comedy. Okay.
Definitely for kids. It's very fart humor type stuff.
Paul Feig and Judd Apatow. Yeah.
And you get Jerry Stiller and Mira in a small role, and they're so sweet.
Yeah.
It's Ben Stiller is like dialed up to 11. It's so, he's so funny.
Like a trial run for his dodgeball character.
Yeah, but I think he goes for it even more in this one. Mm. It's so funny.
I'm checking it out.
Like ripped and just like insane. Yeah,
Blake says, get on the scale, get off the scale, which I'm assuming is a great title. Laura says, American Graffiti. Great, great suggestion. Yeah. Didn't think about that. Another one that was on my short list that I didn't know if it was set in summer, which I'm assuming it is, but you know, it's just not part of the language lexicon of the film. And that both Craig and I had on our last list was Y Tu Mamá También. So for that reason, that one is another runner-up that I totally forgot to mention. So yeah, just as soon as we talked about doing this, my number 10 was just immediate. I mean, my number one. My number one is Do the Right Thing. It is the ultimate summer movie, as far as I'm concerned. There are references to summer throughout the film. You've got Samuel L. Jackson playing Senior Love Daddy, the radio station host, screaming about how it's hot, that it's a hot day in summer. You have shots of newspaper articles talking about it's hot. You've got the song Can't Stand the Heat. It is a hot, hot day in Bed-Stuy. What did you say?
I said that red wall that the men sit in front of.
Oh, yeah. And they're just fanning themselves all the time. I mean, it is a... What's that now?
The Ice Cube scene.
Oh, yes. Yes, worshipping Rosie Perez and her body.
That movie, oddly enough, like, I was watering plants at my stepdad's house today, and the smell of wet concrete, like, because I was the hose going everywhere, that made me think of Do the Right Thing. There's like, you can smell the whole, like, when the water goes on the street, you can smell it. Like,
yeah.
Such a sensory experience. You feel the heat. And yeah, when that water goes, like, oh, like, I know exactly what it's like to be standing there.
And you bring up the ice scene. And here's what's funny. That ice scene is why I can't play Do the Right Thing at the drive-in. Because we were going back and forth about it, because I really wanted to play it, particularly, at this time, Black Lives Matter, and the conversation there and the movement, and I thought that that would be a great film to play. And I might still, if I can find a venue that is a little bit more tucked away, but when we were at venues where the general public could see the screen, we have to be careful with content. Now, language, it's all drive-in. It's all inside your car on the FM transmission. So there is some, and the irony, of course, is we still live in a world where it would be perfectly okay for me to show a film that's visible to the public where a character is strangled to death by the police and or, any of a number of other things that happen and Do the Right Thing, but the nipple, can't show the nipple, right? So that Ice Cube scene has made it so that I cannot show Do the Right Thing until we find a venue that is private. Look at what a masterpiece. It is a movie that I go back and rewatch. And there's movies like that where every time I see it, I'm like, God damn, this is a solid, amazing film at every level. I just think it's a fantastic movie. I also had a weird epiphany about it the other day, which I made a note. I wanted to run this by you. Ever since I first saw it when it came out in 1989, I've been a fan. I've seen it quite a lot of times. I screen it as much as I can, and I've never figured out where I sit with Mookie's decision. You've both seen it, right? At the end of the film, to throw the trash can through the window. And I have heard different people talk about that. Well, was that the right thing to do? Was that doing the right thing? Was it doing the wrong thing? Like, it feels like, you have things like Inception, the spinning top. You got people who are really adhered to one position or another on that, or Mulholland Drive, whatever. But with that scene, it seems to be so nebulous, where people will be like, I've never quite known it. And it occurred to me that I wonder if that was the point. I wonder if the fact that we are still talking about, did Mookie do the right thing at the end of a film called Do the Right Thing, if that is the point. And I wanted to ask you, have you ever had applied an opinion or a feeling about whether or not he did the right thing by basically turning the key on what would become the destruction of Sal's Pizzeria. I will say that as a younger person, I when I first saw it, I thought he did that because they were about to kill beat up or something Sal and his son. They were really closing in on them. They were like swinging the bat defensively. And I remember as a kid thinking, oh yeah, he did that to redirect the anger to the venue and destroy it. But that's never implicitly said. So that's still open for interpretation, but I'm just wondering if you've ever had an opinion on it one way or the other.
Spike himself has said that he's never had a black person ask him that question. Only white people have ever asked him. And
interesting.
And that there's a movie called South Side with you. It's about Barack and Michelle Obama's first date, which was they went and saw it, Do the Right Thing, and afterwards, you know, they get in a discussion with, or they even allude to a discussion with a white couple about that ending, and Barack, to be kind of, you know, apolitical, you know, just says, oh yeah, they were redirecting, you know, the people's anger. And then, you know, Michelle kind of calls him out on it, and he's all like, well, yeah, I mean, but yeah, he was angry. It was an expression of anger, just sure. Like, you know, just, you know, Black life is more valuable than white property, you know, but just, you know, right or wrong, you know, it just, he was pissed off, you know, just that anger had to go somewhere.
And I, you know, and it's interesting. I think I need to really kind of revisit the scene again, because it's also about how Mookie is framed leading up to that, you know, he's, you know,
he does it.
What's that?
He screams the word hate when he does it.
Is that what he screams? I know he screams.
Yeah.
Interesting. Okay. That makes sense. I mean, it's you've got some filmmakers that maybe they don't spoon feed it to you, but at the very least, there's some element of a nuance or a note or a shot or something to sort of imply what it is there, you know, and that's a choice, you know, and so leaving that out is a choice too. Mm-hmm. And so that's really interesting that you should mention what Spike's particular take on that is, because obviously he's the filmmaker. So no, that makes sense. Okay. Yeah. What's up?
I was just going to add that I don't remember if I first saw this movie or if it was a rewatch in a college film history class. And my teacher, my white teacher, he was very, what's the word I want to use? He didn't really trust us to come to our conclusions. He would just sort of yell out, the theme of this is whatever, like during the movie screening in class. And he said, he's doing this so that they won't hurt the pizzeria owner. Like, and so I don't know if that always just sort of colored my interpretation of it, that like, oh, well, the teacher told me that this is what the scene represents. But upon multiple rewatches and growing up a bit.
Yeah, because that was my 13-year-old interpretation. So when I first saw it, that is where my head immediately went. They're about to hurt these people and he's redirecting their anger. But again, as I rewatched it, I'm like, no, that's not it. That's not it. And how much of it is his own act of anger? In other words, you know, one of the questions that always sort of comes to me is, if that group hadn't been there and it was just Mookie reacting to what happened to Radio Raheem, would he have done that, or did it somehow tie into the larger presence of anger? That's the thing I still don't quite know, and I kind of dig that I still think about it. I kind of dig that I'm still like, you know, these are the nuances. I mean, the idea that, you know, that people, you know, when you're that angry and you're trying to express that there's an injustice that you need to, the idea of quite obviously lately there's been a lot of conversation about that. You know, I totally understand where the destruction of property is par for the course. I get it. But you know, again, it was it tied in with what was happening at the larger picture with all those. I still think about it. But thank you for sharing Spike Lee's take on that, because I think that says quite a lot.
And as much as I love Wim Wenders, and I know you love Wim Wenders, I also do hold it a little against him. He was the president of the jury that year at Cannes, and he said that Mookie was not a heroic character, and that's what cost Spike the Palme d'Or.
What did they give it to?
I can't remember.
Yeah, I remember it was like insulting, and that sort of kicked off Spike's lack of a love story with Khan. And I remember Daryl Hannah going up at the Oscars and calling out the Oscars for not acknowledging the film. I mean, look, it is...
Kim Basinger.
What's up?
Basinger, not Hannah.
Kim Basinger, right. Look at me. Shame. Are you sure?
Yes.
Was it Kim Basinger? Okay, wait. I've always remembered that as Daryl Hannah. It's just a masterpiece. Probably my favorite movie of the 80s. I mean, hands down, if not...
Blue
yeah. I, oh God.
You must choose.
Blue Velvet's my favorite. Do the Right Thing is better. Oh, it's so difficult. I just said that out loud. Okay. I just said that out. Do the Right Thing's a masterpiece. Look at it. It's one of those. You know, I'm asked about when you're top 10. I don't think it's ever. It's one of the finest films I've ever seen, and it still holds out. And you know, if I had to, you know. As much as I love Blue Velvet, everyone knows I love Blue Velvet. I'd have to give it to Do the Right Thing. It's just that profound. But anyway, that was fun. That was a lot of fun. So what was the one idea someone came up with? It was, children's films, top 10 kid-friendly scary movies.
Oh.
Kid-friendly.
Yes, I already have a bunch.
So are these movies? Who suggested that? That was Colin. Colin. Are these movies that are kid-friendly? I just spilled coffee all over my desk, excuse me. Are these films that are intended to be scary, spooky for kids, like The Witches, for example? Or are these movies that weren't intended to be scary, spooky, and are for kids,
like
but
Dumbo.
Are... Like Dumbo? Pink Elephants on Parade?
Yeah, that scared the crap out of me as a kid. And it's not all about that. It's that elephant that's made up of just other elephant heads.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That sequence is so incredible, though. Oh, my God. But yes, that is a spooky scene. I know there's a delay, so Colin, if you get this before we sign off, curious to know if it's movies like Dumbo that scared the crap out of us, that were made for us as kids, but scared the crap out of us unintentionally, or movies that are meant to spook and scare, like, you know.
Coraline.
Coraline would be on my list. Nine. Anyway, now we're just doing it right here live on the spot. But nine was one that, have you seen Nine, the cartoon? Or I don't know if it was a cartoon. I think it was a cartoon, not stop motion, a computer. What?
It's animated. We haven't seen it.
Yeah, it's scary. It's kind of twisted. I saw it and was like, I was old enough at that point not to be scared by it, but I was consciously aware that this movie would have given me nightmares as a child. Like, it's just creepy. Movies intended for kids and teens. Now, we know that. The question is, are they movies that were intended for kids and teens that are horror spooky in theme, or movies intended for kids and teens that weren't horror spooky, but had scary moments like Chitty Chitty Bang Bang has a creepy sequence, Willy Wonka has a creepy sequence, intended to be scary. Thank you. All right, so want to do that?
I could be down.
Yep.
Movies that were for kids and families that were intended to be spooky. All right, I'll think about it. That'd be a good one. All right, cool. So we will talk. We will come up with the next date. Folks, thank you so much for watching. This is, as always, a blast. You've got 20 great summer, 18. There were some duplicates. Summer, and all the Friday the 13th, so, you know, over almost 30 films to watch. We hope everyone's being safe. We hope everyone's taking care of yourselves.
Buy Frida masks.
Yes, you can buy a Frida Cinema mask on our website, thefridacinema.org. What's
as
that?
As a person going to work during the pandemic. As an essential worker wearing a mask, it is... by far my most comfortable mask. It's the only one.
Thank you. It is a double layer polyester mask. So we, the company that we ordered from, had made another mask that I wore that I was like shocked how comfortable it was. It was a single layer polyester. And I wrote to them and said, look, this mask is so comfy. It feels a little bit thin. Can you make a double layer one? And they did. And so we ordered Frida Cinema masks. It's a great way to support us. They're $10. Proceeds support our organization. You can get them at thefridacinema.org. You can also learn about our upcoming drive-ins as well as more shows like we're doing, like these shows on our website. And then lastly, one of the ways that we're keeping afloat and keeping our mission alive is to program exactly the kind of films that we would have programmed if we were open, but at home on streaming cinema. So for example, this weekend we're opening a documentary about Shannon Hoon from Blind Melon called All I Can Say. That's pretty amazing. International films, documentaries, we got some animation here and there. We have a film coming up in a couple of weeks that I am crazy about called We Are Little Monsters from Japan that I cannot recommend highly enough. It is a movie that that I really hate that it's not getting a theatrical opening because it deserves it. But you can rent it on our website, We Are Little Monsters. One of the best movies I've seen in a long, long time.
I haven't used it yet, but Grasshopper Films started up their streaming service, projector.tv, and apparently you can, I don't know if it's exclusive to like stuff that, you know, the Frida, but there's a virtual cinema component of their service where you can choose an art house to have a portion of your rental fee go to.
Oh, that's wonderful. Okay. It's,
Project projector.tv and
I did not know about this, so I appreciate that. Everyone check that out too. Can you type that into the chat? I will have to look that up. Thanks for sharing that. That's great. So both of you take care. Say hello to Lola for me. I was kind of hoping for a cameo appearance, but that's okay. I forgot she was not with you tonight, which is why, by the way, we were able to do this at 8 o'clock instead of 9 o'clock.
Yeah, seriously, she would be like bouncing around in the background if she was here.
Elias says I was terrified of Dumbo too. Yeah, no, that was it's a very trippy sequence, and it kind of comes out of nowhere too.
Yeah, why? It's me.
Because those animators were having a lot of fun back then. There are some stories out there. So anyway, thank you. Thank you so much, as always. Where can we learn more about what you're up to?
Blogging. He's been blogging at thecinematiclife.com. Blogging. We're very active on social media. So we're all over.
Instagram. Twitter.
Facebook. We have your Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook and website right there on screen. So this is where you find these wonderful, wonderful people. Craig and Becca'lise, have a very good night. Thanks as always, and we'll do this again soon.
All right.
Bye bye. Good. Thank you. That was fun.
Yeah.